Good morning and good evening, as wherever you are stationed. Welcome and thanks for joining. If somebody can just ping me whether you're able to hear so that we can continue. Okay, cool. So we are able to hear and we are able to see as well. So without delay, I'll start today's webinar. This webinar is about a newly launched course from SAFE called SAFE Lean Portfolio Management, or LPM. I have created a small presentation on this will be the agenda, why we should take a LPM course, what is the course content, what are those functions we are going to talk about, and I'll elaborate the course content a little bit for each of the areas that we are going to talk about. Then the last two parts about who will benefit taking this course and are there any prerequisites, right? Mostly we will not take all the 1 hour, but once we complete going through the session, I'll open it up for questions. Maybe we can chat or use the question and answer option. I'll try to answer as many questions as possible. And also we will talk about when is the next schedule that we are thinking about, right? We'll keep it at the end. Again, thanks for joining. This is the agenda we'll mostly run through today. Why Lean Portfolio Management course? Again, the course content a little elaborated and who can take it up, right? I'll also try to share the slide that I have prepared later once the webinar is completed. So as we know, this is the latest course launched by Scaled Agile in their curriculum. Most of the SAFE courses are role-based, if you see it that way. Not most, all of the courses basically. We have SAFE Scrum Master, SAFE practitioner for teams, then SAFE product owners and product managers for the product owners and product managers. RTE is specifically for RTE roles and responsibilities. And what was missing or what came now is the Lean Portfolio Manager, which will be operating at the portfolio level in SAFE's big picture, right? What are we going to do? Why this LPM? Agility is not just about bottoms up. Agility is also about top down, or both of them together. And many big organizations, what we see is, and realistically so, is agility starts with an initiation at the portfolio level. Your Lean Agile leaders are going to talk about where do we move our company now? Why do we need the transformation, right? They start with that question and then move through the stages of implementing agility through the organization to deliver value end of the day for the customer, right? So till now, SAFE Agilist is the course, which kind of catered to this need of how do I start my transformation, right? How do I lead this transformation? And SPC or SAFE program consultant talked about how do I implement that one, right? And it gave tools and techniques and emanations, so to say, for the audience to kind of go through that implementation stage, right? So LPM fills up that small gap that existed where we were talking about the organization's executives coming together. They really understanding what does it mean at a portfolio level to drive that transformation, right? And what are those tools and techniques, practices, or patterns that are available in the industry? So that's what this course tries to bridge the gap on. And currently, there are a few courses that were run in Boulder at Scaled Agile's headquarters, and also some of the places in US that I know of, and even in Europe, as far as I know. And the response has been overwhelmingly positive around this one. Idea of lean portfolio managers coming together or an executive coming together, executives of the organization really understanding what does it take for the transformation, what are the tools and techniques available for them, was something, I mean, which is very well received worldwide. And through Knowledgehut, as an SPC, I am enabled to take, I have cleared the enablement for this course and also wanted to, I mean, put my thoughts and my experiences working with the portfolio managers and executives in the organization to the use through this course. Why does one want to take up this course? Let's try to look at this this option. This is where, I mean, what we say is this is an opportunity for leaders to capture what is their current state and how do they design that future state, right? Because for any organization, there is always run the business and there is always improve the business initiatives, right? So how do we balance both of them, right? How do we make sure that we stay relevant even in the future? So this is where we try to use Portfolio Canvas, which is a tool to kind of really see where we exist, then do a SWOT analysis and really look at what the future looks like, right? And this will potentially look at what are those important business initiatives that we could achieve the future state. I mean, this kind of helps them to really do that one. The second thought here is, how do we establish a flow at a portfolio level? At a team level, we use Scrum, you use Kanban, along with XP for engineering practices or extreme programming for engineering practices. At a program level, Essential Safe, I mean, guides you to run the PA planning and execute the program increments. Last solutions typically use program of programs, but how do we establish the flow at the portfolio level, right? Like while some of the courses like Safe Agilist looked at this pointer and also gave some certain guidelines around it, we elaborate a lot here, right? And how do we prioritize those initiatives for maximum economic benefit? That's a second thought there. The last thought is, how do I establish budget and guardrails for them, right? Again, there were guidance articles published recently around what are those lean budget guardrails, what are those capacity allocations we need to think of, what are those investment horizons that we are going to talk about, right? We had that one, but here we again elaborate on how do we kind of really look at value stream budgets and how do we measure the lean portfolio's performance itself. I'll talk about the how part. How are we going to accomplish this one? LPM is a workshop style course, which is 3 days, not 2 days, unlike most of the other SAFE courses. What we do here is take an actual scenario, right? I mean, if it is a private class within an organization, it will take an actual scenario of the organization and try to decipher all of these options. If it is a public class, we do have a scenario from a transport corporation, but otherwise, I mean, we can also take up if there are people from one organization and I mean, kind of they're trying to solve one particular problem, we can actually take up their current scenario as well. Idea here is more and more discussions. As I said, it's a workshop format for any tool, any technique, any practice, or any pattern that we are going to talk about. We will utilize actually the example that we have and try to put it into a usage on that particular tool or a technique that we have and get an answer for that one there itself, right? And also we encourage a lot of discussions around that one so that, I mean, the participants are going with a concrete takeaway or a concrete action plan for themselves, really understanding where to stand. What does it look like as well, right? So again, a workshop format where it is more participatory in nature, and also making sure that all the ideas about the tools, techniques, the collaboration that we are talking about is really put into use, right? So, as I said, it's a workshop format. Again, we will look at three functions, which are called out. If any one of you have attended a Safe Agilist program, we have a chapter around that one, concise and short format, where we are talking about three main functions from the Lean Portfolio Manager's viewpoint. First one is a strategy and investment funding. Second one is Agile Portfolio Operations. The last one, Lean Governance, right? I'll elaborate each one of them a little bit more and also talk about what are the tools, techniques, options that we are talking about there, and how does it each of them connect to the enterprise's strategy, right? The first function, strategy and investment funding. We'll talk about a lot of things here, but I have tried to put major portions there. We'll talk about what is an enterprise strategy, right? And also what are the strategic themes that are for the portfolio. Again, I will look at a portfolio as a line of business or an organization within an organization for achieving a certain set of values, right? So here we look at what is the enterprise's strategy, what are those strategic themes, which will catapult the organization into a next orbit, right? This is it's not a short-term vision. It's rather a little longer-term vision on what changes our company, right? What is our strategic direction, that we need to kind of look at it, right? How do we come out with that one? This is where the portfolio canvas helps you, where we talk about the portfolio canvas option of really looking at our current business status, maybe be it revenue, be it our channels that we are using, the KPIs that we are using, the cost that we are thinking about, who are the stakeholders that we have, right? So we look at that one. We put our current business into that portfolio canvas, one pager portfolio canvas, to really understand what is our current state of business, where the money is coming, where the cost we are incurring, what are the game changers, who are our players, right? We talk about that. And based on this portfolio canvas in the class, we are going to look at what are those organizations' strengths and opportunities, and based on them, what could be the future canvas state, right? We look at that, and because of this future canvas state, we would come up with few new initiatives. This is where the lean business case comes in, where we talk about how do we make sure that an initiative that we are taking has an MVP, or does it meet our objectives end of the day? The strategic themes that we have, are we going to meet with those business cases, right? So we really put that a few new epics that we have kind of found out in the class, we have come up with in the class, into those business cases, really understanding what does it take to build, right? And is there an iterative and incremental approach of building that one itself, right? Then we kind of look at, so how do we move away from a project mindset to a product mindset, right? How do we fund our value streams rather than funding a project and kind of asking for more money? How do we fund the value streams, adjust those value streams, right? And once these things are put in place, how do we enable the flow through a portfolio canvas, right? So idea here is we are kind of looking at a flow even at a portfolio level. How do we make sure that the right initiatives are taken care? How do we make sure that only run the business options are not there, and also improve the business options are there? They are given the right capacity allocation. Not just the business functions, how do we take care of the technical functions as well? How do we take care of maintenance options as well? How do we take care of compliance? How do you take care of regulatory options, right? We do talk about those guardrails as well. And again, looking at the investment horizon as well. What is getting me money today? What are the new initiatives we need to take? And also, what could be those potential game changers for our company as well, right? How do we manage, map them to the program and the team level layers as well? So we do look at it. One more interesting thing here is for each of the three functions, we do have a portfolio self-assessment sheet available for the participants as well. So we go through each of these areas of within those functions. I mean, we'll go through each of the functional areas and then look at where do we stand. I mean, do we on a scale of typically 1 to 5, where do I stand? I mean, we do a self-assessment and then move forward. Idea is by the time you complete the course, you would have a radar chart for yourself looking, which kind of tells you the story of where do you stand today. And if you want to draw a future state, where do you want to be? Again, not saying that everywhere you have to reach 5, but from an organization perspective, where do you want to improve, right? You have those improvement areas available for you. And then you can actually map those areas as an action item for you, right? I mean, what are those delta areas as an action item for you as a takeaway and really looking at what do I need to do, right? This could also give a backlog, so to say, for the lean portfolio managers on, okay, these are the 5 things that we need to take care of. What should I take care of first, right? So this is something which is an interesting thought within the course itself. When we go out at the end of the 3 days, we know what is our current business situation. We also have a future canvas on what is a possibility. And also, if we want to reach that, what are those improvement areas? How do I really know that, okay, these are my improvement areas, right? So you have this as a takeaway from the class as well. The second one, portfolio operations. This is where, okay, we have budgeted certain things. How do we coordinate them, right? How do we make sure the portfolio roadmap is healthy? How do we make sure that the portfolio roadmap has enough capacity to take up if something comes in between, right? And this is where two important functions within an organization come into the fore as well. One is the Agile project management office or a product management office. Then the LACE, which is Lean Agile Center of Excellence. Again, not to say that you have to have a APMO and you have to have a LACE, but idea is if you have a PMO, how do we move them to a agile ways of working? Or if you have a transformation office, what are the thoughts there, right? Again, different options are given here as well. What has worked in the industry and what the industry is thinking about, right? An option of an agile PMO or a centralized Lean Agile Center of Excellence, or you can call it as a transformation office as well. So even a decentralized transformation office where it is a hub and a spoke model where there is a very thin central lace, but there are also instances of a Lean Agile Center of Excellences with different business units or different portfolios as well, right? Idea here is if the transformation is started, we need to really know where do we stand. And we need to really know how do we take it forward. We need to really know how do we make sure that all our personnel or all the team members are trained and all the team members have the capabilities to take this forward, right? And also how do we improve the performance of each roles, right? So this is where the APMO and the Lean Agile Center of Excellence comes into picture. And they also talk about communities of practices, either it could be a Scrum Master's community of practice or an RTE's community of practice, or even a Java community of practice. I mean, based on the domain, based on the knowledge, based on the technicalities that are there. So how do we, it's about mostly sustaining the transformation as well, not just starting and implementing, but sustaining the transformation. How do we make sure that the transformation is sustained throughout with an interested effort from the organization, from the whole organization itself? And we also talk about a portfolio sync. This is where, and while we know there is the team, the level, we have Scrum and they have a rhythm. We know that at a program level, there is a program increment. Then there are program level art or an agile release stream syncs as well. But how do we make sure that even at a portfolio level, things become predictable, right? We talk about the portfolio sync. Again, certain guidelines around what could be the area to look at that. I mean, how do we kind of, I mean, again, it could go back to the strategy and investment funding as well. How do we make sure that the lean business cases which are coming in are taken care immediately and quickly? How do we make sure that the guardrails are put in place? How do we make sure that the flow is appropriate, right? So the portfolio sync looks at these options and certain tools and techniques that we could utilize to move forward as well. Last part, one very interesting part as well, we'll also talk about agile contracts. We know there is fixed bid, we know there is time and material contracts, and there are certain things in between, right? While each one of them have their pro and cons, how do we work it in an agile way, right? I mean, this is where making sure that there is a win-win for both the supplier and the customer, right? So we will look at some options here again. We will also elaborate on certain things on how do we move from a complete time and material or complete a fixed bid way of working to a more agile way of working, which makes sure that the compliances are met, which makes sure that both the parties are in a win-win situation, which makes sure that non-reliable parts or not so good intention products are cut quickly, and there is a end of the day there is value for the customer, right? We talk about the agile contracts here as well. Another thing is, as I repeatedly saying, each of these things, I mean, we'll not just talk theoretically but actually put into the practice of at each step. So that's why, I mean, while the course content might look very small or, I mean, very precise, we do have a lot of time spending during this through the working, where we do see that each of the things are put into practice, and we look at what is happening, right? I mean, when you say communities of practice, we really look at what can we do to improve the community of practice, right? So sorry for this. I was just checking whether there are. We do have these, each of the things, I mean, put into practice as well there. So the lean portfolio managers are going to go back with the right ammunition for them, in the sense that they know their current business, they know where to change, they know what could be those tools and techniques that are available for them to really look for the change, right? The last part is on the lean governance. Yes, I mean, we are funding, we are operating. How do we govern, right? How do we make sure that it is in a sustainable manner? This is where adjusting your budgets dynamically. We talked about the value stream budgeting. Again, the budgeting also could change over a period of time. Market dynamics will change. Government regulations might change. You might have something very exciting that is coming up for your business, which you don't want to leave it out just for the sake of, I don't have the money for this year, right? So how do we adjust those budget dynamically, right? This is where, I mean, we kind of look at one such tool, which is a very collaborative one, which is called as a participatory budgeting, right? It's a it's a process of democratic deliberation, I can say, and a decision making where everyone in the organization, I mean, at the portfolio level, the stakeholders at the portfolio level, they really get together and really look at how do I allocate my budget, right? So as far as I know, it came out in Brazil or somewhere where citizens were able to participate in the municipality budgets and really look at how do we spend the money on that one, right? So we really look at that option or a tool of sitting in a room, really putting out the money on the table, and really looking at how much percentage, I mean, I should put into the run the business, how much percentage I should put it on improving the business, or I mean, putting on the new initiatives as well, right? This is where, I mean, we do prioritize epics as well, which are coming newly as a new initiatives, merger and acquisitions, our technology changes. It could be any of that, right? And we'll also look at two more things. One is the performance itself, lean portfolio's performance itself. What are those could be those measurements, right? I mean, at the team level, we might say, okay, number of stories, velocity, unit test coverage. At the program level, we could look at predictability. We could look at how many features we are delivering, what is the throughput, I mean, what's the cycle time. We're looking at all of them, but how does a lean portfolio manager measure their performance, right? It's a dicey thing. I mean, in some of the cases where it is not just a tangible number that you are looking at, but how do I make sure that the customers are getting a value? So there is again certain guidelines around what could be those starting measures that you can start using that one, right? And we'll also look at certain things like technology business management. How does the IT say, okay, I'm spending this much dollars, but what's the value that I'm giving, right? How do I measure that one itself? So this is where we talk about the technology business management option of really showcasing what's the money spent, what's the value. And the last part, CapEx and OpEx, what to capitalize, what is operational expense. Certain guidelines from a SAFE perspective, we are going to look at the initiatives that we have taken in the class, the MVPs that we have talked about, maybe how many program increments we are going to take up for this one. And then what is CapEx for me? What is OpEx for me within that one, right? So again, I mean, it gives a lean portfolio managers a way of really looking at how do I make sure that the compliances are met? How do I make sure that I have some visibility around what is happening on the ground, right? We'll also look at some of the compliance aspects because organizations doesn't work in silos anymore. Any industry, any company is regulated, some of the companies have to follow certain compliances. We'll look at how do we develop those compliances also continuously, not just at the end of everything, but rather how do we involve the compliance as something like a built-in compliance, right? I mean, not just the quality, even the compliance is built in, right? And we'll also look at some patterns of quality management system. How do we make sure that quality management system also goes through the PDCA cycle now and makes it faster and quicker as well? Again, self-assessment is available for all the three functions. And once we complete these three major functions, we will have a self-assessment radar itself. So the last small chapter, what it deals with is taking an action item, right? I mean, this is where we kind of put together what does my radar look like? What's the future state for me? And what are those areas? And what are those action items that I'm going to take back, right? And this will definitely help them to really look at if I have 5 items or 6 items, what are those 1 or 2 things that we need to concentrate in our organization quickly, and how do we move towards agility for the organization, right? This kind of, I mean, completes the course coverage in brief. Last two parts, who will benefit? While there is no prerequisite as such, but looking at the context of the portfolio, these are the people who are going to benefit out of this course. executives and leaders, when we say, when it's a CXO level and VPs, mostly who have the authority for the budget and also looking at the initiatives, run the business and improve the business initiatives, they will definitely get these tips, tools, techniques to move forward. Enterprise architects are really looking, who are looking at the technology perspective for the long run of the company. Product and solution managers are definitely, again, they have a very critical and significant role to play because end of the day, they are the voice of the customer for the teams and even for the management, right? They are very close to the business. They are knowing the pulse of the market and they are going to really put forward their thoughts on what are those initiatives? How do we carve out this MVPs? How do we kind of push it to market as well? Business unit managers and program office personnel, mostly from the PMO's list as well. SPCs, definitely one more tool in our kitty. Really looking at how do I make sure that the whole organization is talking in the same language, right? This does make sure those aspects as well. Few more human resources, because organization is not just IT. As we know, it also involves the human resources functions as well. We do evolve the human resources functions to really look at the newer roles and responsibilities and newer things that are emerging in the market from that as well. And definitely, few more roles like RTEs, STEs, epic owners within the program or the portfolio level as well. So they will also definitely get benefited. Last part for this webinar, what are the prerequisites? Again, I have taken this as is from Scaled Agile website. All are welcome to attend the course regardless of experience. But again, as I said, based on the context, these are the recommendations. Familiarity with Agile concepts and principles, because we are not going to dwell any deeper on the Agile concepts. We expect with the experience, the lean portfolio managers or who wants to operate at that level they have, they are already familiar with that. They're bought into an idea of improving agility of the organization. They understand, they kind of show that skills as well, right? Ideally, a participant would have already attended a leading safe or a safe POPM course. This sets a context very well for them on what's a framework all about, because again, we are not going to talk too much about Scaled Agile as a framework. That's not the intention. We are really knowing that these are the organizations who are already thinking about safe. These are the organizations who have seen value in executing in a Scaled Agile way. So this will definitely help. Again, it may not be a mandatory thing, but if you would have attended a leading safe or a POPM course, that will definitely help you to take it from there onwards. Experience of working in a safe environment. Courses are one thing. Experience, real life experience is another thing, right? So because this is a workshop format exercise, workshop format course, what we recommend and what we look for is also people bringing their practical challenges, bringing their practical experience or a practical statement itself, so that we go away with a real thing to work on later as well, right? This is the end of whatever slides I have. I'm open for questions. I do see some questions on the chat window and also some questions in one open question on the question and answer window as well. I'll start addressing one by one. You can also start posting your questions as well. So from Rajeshri Arjun, Do I need to attend a formal training on LPM to teach back LPM as an SPC on your enablement page? You can actually do the lean portfolio management enablement itself. Then you can teach the class. But however, it is again like any other course. It is recommended. You can always attend a course, and then you will have more practical experience of doing it as well. That way, it is up to you. But one more, even when I did the enablement, the first question it asked is, you do have the experience in working at a portfolio level, right? So that's a kind of a prerequisite which Scaled Agile takes from the participants. So because if you are talking about, say, Agile contracts, you really need to know what are real contracts as well. If you are talking about CapEx and OpEx, you need to be able to give a real life scenarios as well, right? It goes that way. Pranjal is on the webinar as well. Thanks for joining, Pranjal. He'll also be able to answer a few questions. Pranjal is from Scaled Agile. He's the partner manager for India and Asia. Second question, will we get a recording? Yes, this session is recorded. So we will find out a way to share the, we should have all the participant details. We will share the recording as well. And slides, yes, definitely I'll share the slides. I'll also add the SAFE's LPM course page, so which is open for everyone anyway. So that also kind of gives you, more thoughts around that. And one more interesting thing is, if you are interested in any of the, say, participatory budgeting, if you are interested, there are guideline articles on SAFE page as well, which you could quickly go through. Another question, do we need to clear validation exam before giving trainings? Yes, you need to clear the validation exam. The validation exam is available for SPCs on the platform, community platform, in the enablement option. We need to go through the course content videos, typical like everything else, then the practice test and the actual test. Two more questions I have. We have PA planning at program level. Similarly, large solution SAFE has pre and post PA sessions, but portfolio SAFE does not depict any such similar sessions. As we talked about now, we have portfolio sync. It was always there, but it was not really pronounced so well in the course materials or in the framework itself. Idea is, if you ask me a minute, again, my personal view, it is about, it's a two or three things. First one is, any organization is going to be different from each other, right? So you never know, right? If it is a product organization where market is changing very fast, portfolio managers are mostly going to meet almost daily, right? If it is mostly a service organization, you have the businesses set in. There is a day zero and there is a day one, right? Day zero sees a lot of actions, but day one is more streamlined, right? So this is where, there is no a specific guideline on you have to meet every day or you have to meet monthly or weekly. What I do see is portfolio sync is minimum once in a month now and more often as needed. There are also guidelines around what you could do every month and what you could do once in a quarter or once in 6 months as well. Again, those are guidelines, but depending on the organization's priorities, depending on what the organization is heading to, right? They do look at different options and tools and techniques there. So there is a rhythm now, right? There is a rhythm which the organizations, can look at looking in a particular way. And as I said, in the class, when we go out of the class, we do take back what are those sync options that I'm going to use as well. So that's also part of the curriculum. One more question, a pointed one at that. How is the job market for SAFE and which will be the best certification in SAFE to start with, right? I don't know whether I can answer it to the full satisfaction, but as we know, the version one's state of agility survey, SAFE is the number one scaling framework, so to say. It has, few years back, it has overtaken a scrum of scrum as just a way to scale your operations, technologies, or whatever it is, right? So it is talked about. The case studies that are there on the Scaled Agile website are a testimony for that. Definitely, you could go through the case studies that are there on the Scaled Agile website. Definitely, if you are working in healthcare, you will find enough number of case studies from healthcare domain. If you are onto the services business, you will find enough case studies from there also. That will give you a real picture of what the industry is thinking about. Why are they using SAFE as a framework, right? That definitely helps there. And a best certification, role-based, I would go with the role-based. If you are a leader manager, I would say SAFE Agilist. If you are a Scrum Master, SAFE Scrum Master would be the starting point for you. And it is two folds for me. One is the current role that you are operating at. Another one is the role you are aspiring to, right? Both could be your decisive factors how do you want to make that choice? And you could always connect to me on LinkedIn, and I'm happy to answer any questions on what is the course right course for me and how do I go about it. I'll be more than happy to answer those queries, because each one's context, each one's aspirations are going to be different. I can't give one answer for that. Rasul and Kuldeep, thanks for your compliments. Does LPM course covers both enterprise and government? Enterprise, yes, it covers in detail. Government, SAFE for government practitioners, that's a course which kind of talks more from a government organization or dealing with government perspective, right? We don't really talk a lot of things on the LPM course. But definitely, when compliance portion comes in, we do have a thought or a really looking at what are those things for my organization and how do I deal with that one, right? So we do talk about that in that case. Interesting question or an important question. When is the course scheduled in Bangalore? We are looking at potentially mid-October or early November. The thought is, one is to give just a little bit of time and also a lot of holiday season in between, Dasara, Deepavali as well. We are trying to work around those days as well. And also we are toying with the idea of, is it Friday, Saturday, Sunday or weekdays? What does work, right? So once we have some clarity on those as well, but not later than November, right? November 1st or 2nd week. We have some more time. I'll be happy to answer if there are more questions. Pranjal, I've allowed you to talk.
Hey, Ashwini, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, Pranjal.
Perfect. I'm sorry, I joined in a bit late.
No problem. I should have let
you know earlier.
Yeah.
So I think interesting questions, and I really enjoy when people ask the questions relevant to them personally as well. So thank you so much, whoever asked the question as to how is this certification going to help you. And like any other certification, if you can't put that to practice, there is no use of doing it, right? So think about it, that how would you put that to practice? What is the future or the current organization that you're part of? How you can influence them to adopt SAFe if they already are not doing that? And that is the idea behind these courses anyway, because we expect you to be the change agent. And change happens, it's difficult. And that's where the real value of this certification would come out to be as well. So always be on the lookout for the opportunity that where is it that you can implement all these learnings. At the end of the day, it's not about the certification, it's about the knowledge and how you can implement and learn from the application of that knowledge. So it's a great course. And for the SPCs, if there are any SPCs, I think I heard a couple of questions which might have been coming from the SPCs. Use this LPM course as a tipping point in your enterprise engagements. So when you're going in an enterprise and talking to them and influencing them to adopt SAFe, then instead of positioning leading SAFe, you can instead also position LPM course, because hey, who the audience is going to be? The audience is going to be the senior leaders, the portfolio managers, and they are the one who are the decision makers who would drive and support the transformation using SAFe. So you could also use LPM as a course, as a tipping point class, and get them to a value stream workshop. And if you're on the other side of the table, use LPM to learn more about how SAFe approaches a portfolio level transformation. So now you would also be on the, be able to understand how does SAFe support a portfolio, the entire portfolio, not just the program level essential SAFe transformation as many organizations have already been seeing in India. So on both sides of the table, I think it's a great tool, great source of knowledge, and you can benefit from both the aspects. In fact, to share with you some stats, we do not have any LPM course yet posted in this geography, because of course it's a newer course released on 8th of July, as you might know. But in the US and Europe, we have a lot of courses. Most of the courses are being delivered by Scaled Agile itself. And I believe there are 50 plus classes which have been posted in that region in this time frame, and all of them have been sold out. We have our annual summit. We posted a class. It got sold out within a few days, and we are thinking of posting another LPM class during the summit. And we had been receiving great feedback from the audience. We were at Agile 2019 in Washington, D.C. We were at the Gartner event in Washington, D.C. recently. And our booth was overwhelmed asking about the Lean Portfolio Management course. So it's receiving great feedback and overwhelming response. So I would encourage all of you to participate, learn a bit more about it. You can always go to scaledagileframework.com and find Lean Portfolio Management over there and use that knowledge to either help your current organization, or if you're looking for a job, then see if that organization is already practicing SAFe and position that knowledge, not the certification, but the knowledge. And then of course, if you are, if you don't find that SAFe is not being used right now, in your current or the future organization, then be the change agent and help drive that. And of course, Ashwini has been, has, I would say, tremendous amount of experience in implementing SAFe across different enterprises. So please pair up, find out opportunities where you can both go together and that will give you some initial momentum. So I guess number one step for me could be, if I were you, to attend this course, make myself knowledgeable, get certified, and then find the opportunities where you can start applying that. And in that process, maybe pair up with Ashwini and Knowledgehut to see how you can both go together. Just wanted to share my 2 cents, maybe it's more than 2 cents.
Yeah.
I just wanted to share.
Thanks, Pranjal. It helps. It helps. Definitely helps. Yeah, I'm open for those pairing up conversations as well. Yeah. And again, thanks, Pranjal. One more question from Rajeshri. How does it is different from a conventional portfolio management? And also, I think you have elaborated your question as well. We do undergo in a conventional way of a screening, prioritization, optimization, and balancing. How does LPM take that into factor? These are basic hygiene factors, yes. And when we talk about screening, again, if I can give a direct one-to-one mapping, we do go through a prioritization. I mean, we do go through really looking at what's a business case, right? But in a leaner way, in a faster way, better way. Optimization and balancing, it's not, it's no more just an art. There is a science given to that one as well, where we say, what are the guardrails we need to put, right? And when we talk about participatory budgeting, we do kind of look at how much money do I have, where do I invest as well, right? And again, it's a little democratic process as well, where all the stakeholders are involved. And offline, I'll be able to, I'm happy to converse more on this one as well, if you're interested. Two more questions I have. One is the cost details, goes with the SAFE's scaled agile's pricing policy. 1,90,000 plus taxes is the price for a 3-day course. How do we encourage leaders to go for it being a trainer? I think Pranjal gave you very good points. If you are on this side of the table, what is in it for me? If you are on that side of the table, what is in it for me? For me, again, I mean, personally for me, as a change agent, the new tools and techniques that I have in my kitty, right? And the persuasion also becomes a little more clear for me now with how do I measure the effectiveness, I mean, overall effectiveness as well. But as a trainer, if you are looking at your organization, how do we encourage those leaders to go through the training? Again, what's the value that they get from this one, right? So that could be the starting point on what are those tools, techniques, practices, or patterns that you are going to learn through these 3 days. Not just learning, but also have an action item or a backlog for yourself. That is a real quick takeaway for me.
And just to add to that, the end goal is not getting people trained on LPM, right? Yeah. The end goal is how do they benefit from the implementation of SAFE in their organization, the real business outcomes, right? So keeping the end goal in mind that what is it that they would want to achieve in next 6 months to 1 year, or maybe 1 year plus, and what are the challenges that they're facing right now? If you have that clarity, that will help you work it backwards, that I can help, and maybe you can start prescribing, being like a doctor, right? You analyze the situation, you assess the people, and then you prescribe. So you prescribe an approach that tell them that in order to achieve these business outcomes, you need to adopt SAFE, and SAFE can be implemented at various levels. And then at the maximum benefit, when we call the lean enterprise, that the enterprise agility or the business agility concept, when that is infused and induced in the organization, that's where you function in more, I would say, leaner, more agile fashion. The entire organization in that, and the entire business is then called agile. And that is where you start positioning different products. And one of that product could be LPM class, right? So I would say, ask the question that what is the pain point that the customer is trying to solve? How is it that they want to improve their business outcomes? And what is it for them personally? How would you make them successful if they are able to influence their leadership by adopting SAFe or maybe doing LPM class, right? And then you start working backwards. These are the problems. This is how you solve it. There are various paths which lead to the solution. One of the path is by taking a lean portfolio management class, which will get you the answers and provide you the approaches in which you can start rolling out adoption of SAFe. And then as an SPC, you influence that, help drive that, and coach those that process, those teams, and so on and so forth. So it's I know it's a long answer, but that's the most effective answer. And I'm sure, Ashwini, you would have seen that in your experience that, you know, just positioning a certification might not really influence a senior leader within an organization. But when you talk to them about how is it that you can help their organization achieve those business outcomes that they're working towards, and what are the pain points that they're going through right now, which keeps them awake at night, and how you can help address those, like faster time to market, increase productivity, increase engagement, and so on and so forth. And that's where they listen to you. And then you start positioning your products at the end of it. And maybe LPM is one of those products.
Yeah. Thanks, Pranjal. Just to address one more question on, we also validate that SAFe can, address the business problem. Probably we need to see if the problem qualifies to be solved by SAFe. Typically, this is where the toolkits help me. Even before going there, I would maybe encourage you to have a half a day to one day lean portfolio workshop. The toolkit available for SPCs. So that could be a starting of the conversation where we really talk about what are your pain points rather than talking about even a course or implementation itself, right? Then like Pranjal said, as a doctor, I'll be able to say, okay, I know this one, this could solve your problem. What do you think about it, right? We have 2 more minutes. If there is any last question, I'll be happy to answer. Thanks a lot, everyone, especially Pranjal. Thanks for taking your time. Have a good day. Have a good weekend as well. Weekend is nearby. Thank you. As I said, I'll share the...
Happy learning.
Yeah, I'll share the slides and also the recording with all the participants. Thank you.